A very good afternoon and warm welcome and namaste to everyone present here. Thank you for joining us today to celebrate UNESCO's Global Media and Information Literacy Week 2021. We are all eager to know about how media is impacting and what are some of the best ways to stay positive, happier, and safer on the internet and digital media. I'm Mridula Singh, your host. Before we move, a quick view overview of recent work of NextSchools. I know all of you are eager to ask questions and know more about our topic that we have today: media and information literacy and well-being for our children, teens, and youth.
www.nextschools.com is an information hub for parents, children, educators, and school. We are committed to cyber safety and media and information literacy through our project Happier and Safer Internet, which focuses on critical thinking, online safety, and digital wellness. We have built programs for the whole school community engagement. NextSchools is also launching India's very own Cyber Safety Awareness Week from 1st to 7 December 2021. NextSchools is proud partner of Stop, Think, Connect education campaign by National Cybersecurity Alliance, USA, UNESCO's alliance partner, champion for the first Identity Management Day and Cybersecurity Awareness Month champion. We are inviting schools, teachers, children, parents, NGOs, and organizations to partner with us for deeper social impact.
Now, without taking much ado, I would like to welcome Dr. Parikh, who is not just a distinguished psychiatrist, but his work also spans in many, many other areas. Dr. Parikh is an eminent psychiatrist and has played a significant role in enhancing the image and reach of mental health across the country. He completed his MBBS and MD in psychiatry from Civil Hospital Ahmedabad and topped the university in both. The Fortis National Mental Health Program is one of the only comprehensive, multi-city, multi-centric mental health care program in the world, with over 80 expert centers and 20 centers across India. Dr. Parikh is also a well-known speaker, and he has been invited to share his views on various community of parents and children. We will have more conversation around his work and, of course, the edumedia literacy among children and teens. I will open the forum and invite Dr. Parikh to let us know the topic itself. So the first question is, of course, give us a sense of how media impacts mental health in this very connected world during the pandemic.
No, I think we need to go before the pandemic to understand that media has always played an interface in the an impact on children. And I think we need to really clearly understand. I have been taking, as a part of the Fortis School Mental Health Program, media literacy workshops now for over 6 to 7 years. And we realized that because of social media, digital media, advertisements, entertainment media, gaming, there are so many vectors which were acting on young people. So how they engage with media, how they use the right filters for media is integral to their well-being. So you need to split the mental health aspect in two parts. One is a direct influence that happens on yourself, because in today's time, you have a portrait self, a digital self that you show to the world. And then you have a real self. And if there is a difference between the real and the portrait self, then you'll be constantly struggling with dichotomy on your own self. Second aspect is the messaging that media gives. And we all know what social learning is. We know the impact of how learning happens through media. For example, robust evidence for over what, 6 or 7 decades, that how watching aggression brings out aggression in children. So if they watch violence or violent programs, what it does in them. So media has the power to influence both positively and negatively. And that's where media literacy comes into the picture. What the pandemic did was, because everything was happening digitally, education, recreation, social connectedness, and obviously information gathering. So because all of that became digital, what changed was, one, increased time spent. Two, because other stimulations were going out of the availability and accessibility of children, that in itself created a void. And that's where the concerns were, that the social connectedness, peer connectedness, sport, outdoor activity, physical activity, music and arts. So when that got impacted, so it does impact the overall well-being of children. And I think that's the way we need to look at mental health and media.
Yeah, very, very well said, that we have to look media and from not just the pandemic time, but yes, before that also it was happening. And it has become a part and parcel of our everyday life. 24/7, we are connected on devices. More our children are, you know, on the internet because of their school. The learning has started happening on the various online medium. We will also, the one of the very interesting questions, as we are talking about, you know, most of our audience are also the teens and the young children. They ask this question, that we are on the internet and the challenges that are there on the internet. Most of the children, they go viral and everybody wants to try that. Why is that behavior? And despite knowing so much of risk involved in each and every challenge that is there, some of them are good also. It's not that. Like during the COVID, we have seen that hand washing challenge was there. Keep your hands safe. So these kind of good ones are there, but some of them are really, really dangerous. So what do you have to say about it, Dr. Parikh?
It is the influence. The influence that happens in multiple levels. The influence of how the portrayal of a particular challenge is done. So when you over-sensationalize it, glamorize it. The second aspect is peers. Sometimes young people experience peer pressure towards conformity. I'll do the way my friend is doing. Sometimes it's reaching out to that need to experiment. Sometimes it is reaching out to the vulnerability to break rules. There are various reasons and rationales which are there. And this whole aspect about, because it is viral, you need to be a part of it. So to young people listening, every time you want to be a part of a viral movement of sorts, think about the uniqueness of your own self. Our goal and our path has to be to express our unique self. I don't need to be a part of a herd. I am who I am. And that's the only way to look at it. Having said that, it's important that schools, media, social media platforms, role models, educators, parents, government agencies, we all need to constantly talk about media literacy, because media information and what media portrays is not always in our control. But if we create the right filters, right literacy, which can mitigate these effects, and children can utilize as they grow up media for positive purposes and not for negative impact. And I think that's something we all need to appreciate, understand, and implement.
So are you hearing it out, children, and also the parents? Yes, we have a collective responsibility. the children are out there. Sometimes the peer pressure also plays a role in this, Dr. Parikh. And before that, I'll just ask some of the children who are there and even the adults. We have also might be taken, you know, some of the internet challenges. If you have taken, my chat is open. You can put down which challenges. And if you don't want to put down, you can just say yes or no. So is it the peer pressure also somewhere which, you know, makes them that impulsive to take on those kind of challenges and just imitate what is going on in that entire scenario of the social networking websites? Even sometimes in the real life scenario, we see such things, but they are not highlighted in a way that we see on the things that are happening in the media, the digital media particularly.
Because we get swayed away by what is trending for the past 1.5 hours. That's the only way to look at it. And we need to, that's why bring in media literacy as an empowering life skill to young people, to students. That's the way to look forward. Like I said, of course, peer pressure may have its own role. No debate around that. But we can't single out peer pressure. There are multiple vectors, multiple aspects which are happening here. That's why our best case scenario, and I think that's why when UNESCO has this media information and literacy week, the whole logic is that what is in our control? We can empower young people with skills, education. We can't control what's happening in other parts, what is not in my control. So we need to focus upon on what we can do as a solution to the problem rather than over-evaluating just the problem.
Yes, very true. So we have to, you know, understand the entirely the media literacy or the media in particular, how it is coming to you, where it is coming from. That's what Dr. Parikh is highlighting, that you will have to understand literacy. What is media literacy? It is just, you know, deep delving into media, how you engage with particular picture or image that is shown to you. And if you are engaging, are you thinking, are you taking a pause? And as he's also saying that UNESCO is working towards it, you will be delighted to know that UNESCO is also launching a new framework of curriculum. They had a framework of curriculum which was old, but on 11th of November, we will get a new curriculum altogether, which can be used by the educators. And as parents also, I think it is very important to just go and looking at the information, where it is coming from, how it is coming from. Start the conversation with your children. The children can also start conversation amongst their friends. If somebody, you feel that, yes, my friend is not doing something, you know, which is in the interest or in the right mindful action on the internet, you can also go and have a meaningful, positive conversation in a very friendly way. So this is where media and information literacy education plays a very, very critical and vital role. Another aspect and very, very common question that was asked across, because children are also sometimes they don't know how much time they are spending on a particular game. And the parents are also similarly asking these days, because all of us are home stuck most of the time. The situation during the lockdown, it was really bad, but still we are not going out the way we were going out. And one of the getaways, maybe, you know, the socially hanging out is also the games that all the teens, children and adults, all of us are doing. And besides this also, some of the parents have written that my child is always in the room. And some children have also written, I have no control over the time that I spend on various gaming websites and apps. So do you think that the child is addicted, or is this a gaming addiction, or is it a gaming disorder, real gaming disorder? How do you describe it, Dr. Parikh?
No, various aspects to that. Every time somebody is using internet does not necessarily mean that it's a addictive response. More importantly, online gaming is recognized as a disorder. In addictive disorders, online gaming does feature. And yes, online gaming for some people can be like a substance use or an addictive disorder, where you start using the game, then you want to do it more. If you don't do it, you almost feel that irritable withdrawal happening. You use it more and more. It impairs your physical health, your academic, your social relationships, your sleep patterns, and you are unable to stop or reduce it. If that happens and you continue to have an impairment in your overall well-being and functionality, yes, it could well be an addictive process in the making, and you need to talk to your parents and your school counselor. But one also needs to understand that when we talk about overusage of digital world, this is not a COVID only conversation. Pre-COVID as well, the conversations around, is there more internet use happening? Is there more indoor engagement by young people happening? Is there more social media use happening? That has been there for some time. We need to understand that we need to help children realize why they need to take breaks, how they need to take breaks, what they can do alternative. We encourage social engagement. We encourage talking on the phone vis-a-vis texting. We encourage meeting with COVID appropriate behavior whenever it's possible over videos. Similarly, art, music, creativity, pets, plants, we develop more interests so that there is a moderation of use and a balance of use. It's not that it's bad. It's the balance when it is lost. It causes concern that it has a negative impact on our life without any question around that. And that's why balance is so important.
So well said, and very good takeaway for all of us. We have to balance between the online and the real world. We have to balance. We have to equally go outdoor, have some time with ourselves on the play activities that we do outdoors, and screens are also important. Sometimes it is also that we are on the screen, but it is not necessary the quantity matters. Sometimes the quality also matters. Isn't it, Dr. Parikh? The quality of the time we are spending on various media and devices, like we do so many activities for our official work. Sometimes we are stressed out because, yes, we have some deadlines to meet. Similarly, for children also, if you have some project work to complete, you are more on the digital device. That way you are using the digital devices, the digital media and everything very, very productively and meaningfully. So quantity versus the quality, isn't it a question that we should be also asking when we are talking about the screen times?
No, actually, not really, because these are completely different aspects. Even if you are doing something quality, and if you end up spending several hours a day only doing digital work for several days in the week without taking a break, even though you are doing something that's important and purposeful, even then you'll need a break. So let's not discount the need of taking a break, whether it's homework, studies, examination, meetings, engagements, anything else. At the same time, of course, you'll have to learn to choose purpose and purposefulness. That goes without saying. So work-life balance, or the right balance for life when it comes to students or adults, has to be a part of our well-being approach.
Very true. Yes. Take a break. So this is one of the good things that is coming. We are also, when we are doing our cyber warrior and cyber safety programs, we give tips and advice on taking a break, a push-up, maybe, 10 push-ups if you don't remember anything before you pick up your devices. It's something you can also experiment with, and it will be a good physical exercise as well as, your thought process. 10 seconds at least you will think, why I'm picking up my device? Is it necessary for me to pick up that device, or I can be just, you know, not taking any device and I can work around on something, some activity that is more, you know, physically satisfactory for them. Dr. Parikh, you have on your team has also worked. I was going through all your work and I found out that you have worked a lot in exam stress relieving tips and advice for both children and for the parents. So what is it exactly? And I would put it in two parts. Number one is distraction when I'm preparing for the exams. And number two, because social media, when the results are out, even if I am good, bad, it doesn't matter. My academic result. But sometimes, you know, uncle, aunts, my distant cousin, my peers, they post the exam results and there is some anxiety around it. So how to cope with both the situation? Pre-exam preparation, when the exam preparation is a distractor, and secondly, when the results are out and everything is floating around on the social media networking websites.
The second one is an obvious one. We are all unique people. Right now, the T20 World Cup is going on. So a batter bats, a bowler bowls. You don't evaluate a batter on the wickets and you don't evaluate a bowler on the runs. And that's life. We are all different people, unique people. I'm a psychiatrist. You'll ask me questions around depression. I'll know or anxiety or sleep-related issues. I'll probably know a lot many more. But if you'll ask me a single question on, let's say, cardiology or diabetes, I will have zero answers to that. And I can't be feeling bad about not knowing that it isn't my subject. It is not my expertise. That's life. And when it comes to social media, well, I said it at the start, I'm saying it here again. You can't be a part of a herd. You have to be a unique individual. Be unique. You can't compare. It frankly doesn't matter how many followers. It doesn't matter likes and dislikes. To be honest, it really doesn't matter. In the large purpose of life and the movement of life, you will have so many ups and downs and you navigate through life. Probably the thing that will matter least is going to be how many followers you have. That's the reality of life. So if you get an exam result, you like it, excellent. Keep working hard, raise your own benchmarks. You don't like it, learn from it. Learn, where did you go wrong? Or where did you go incomplete? What changes you bring in your own self? Implement it the next time, you'll do well. That's the only way to look at results. There is no exam which is a final exam. You'll continue taking exams throughout your life. When it comes to preparation pre-exams, I have maintained it. Study around the year. Have a good work ethic, which will help you in years to come. Learn how to take breaks. Seek help. Learn the right kind of study skills, which help in your concentration, memory, have a good routine, balance it with your social life, balance it with your stimulations, your recreations and relaxations, and do a lot of self-tests, stay positive, learn from mistakes, focus on your strengths. And like I said, exams will keep coming. Every now and then, you may not call them an examination anymore. But even if tomorrow you are the CEO of a big company, every month or every day is going to be like an exam. They'll just not use the word exam for that. That's the only difference.
So very true. So we have to, you know, bounce back also. Isn't that important? One exam or maybe no post like is something, you know, I am on the social media. The website receives 250,000 followers on the website of Next Schools, but I receive zero likes and comments on my post. But when I look at it other way, the traffic is coming on the pages that I have shared. So you have to look at it from a holistic point of view. It's not necessary that somebody has to come on your portfolio to like and comment. Similarly, for the exams also, exams are not one-time test of life. You will have many, many tests, as Dr. Parikh has also pointed out, in life. It may be a small thing. Don't get anxious about it. Be a little patient. And the life is full of opportunities out there. So we have, you know, Dr. Parikh, many, many, I have been asked in the chat also, our audience are very impatient and they are eagerly wanting to ask you questions. I have very special guest also, in our virtual room, and she happens to be my very dear virtual friend, Ms. Sami Sahani, who is author and expressive arts therapy practitioner. Sami, please ask your question.
Hi, Mridula. Thank you for the introduction that you gave of me. Thank you so much. And also for the invitation to join the talk. I must say, it was a very, very enlightening and very heartening to hear Dr. Parikh today. After the author and expressive arts therapy practitioner title, I'm also a mother of two children. And as a parent, I think that was very, very enlightening what Dr. Parikh shared with us. Thank you so much, Doctor. And my question to you would be, I've done a lot of counseling with my children and sitting next to it. I think the last 2 years have been so much of online work. I really would like you to share a few more points about how to make children understand the difference between the real world and the things that they're exposed to online most of the times. Just
That's media literacy. I mean, you'll have to, one, I think it also depends upon the adults around children. Adults themselves need to be a lot more careful. It's how your interface as adults happens in front of children. Whether it is forwarding a WhatsApp message, whether it is being swayed away by a fake piece of news, be it your engagement with reality television or television per se, be it you're using something shown in media as an example, so on and so forth. I mean, there are various errors we make in communication as well. But media literacy has to be something that we educate children very clearly. And we've been doing media literacy workshops and training modules for a very long time. And we have young people who then train other children as well as a part of the Fortis Pro Social Peer Moderator. And I think that's one thing we all need to understand. Integrate mental health in education. When you integrate media literacy, psychological, first aid, and mental health curriculum, these three aspects need to be integrated in the education system. Goes without saying.
Thank you so much, Doctor. I think just reiterating these points again and again for parents and children, I think that's we should be doing continuously on a continuous basis. So I'm taking that back as a parent. Thank you so much, Doctor.
Thank you, Sami, for being here. Yes, media literacy is a whole lot of learning. It is a very, very deep nowadays, a separate topic or subject that you can study. There are scientific ways of understanding how you are engaging with media, what is the impact of media, and also what are the different ways or the best practices you can follow in everyday life so that there is positive and happier aspect of media that you are consuming, because we are all producers and consumers of media today. No exceptions out there, all age group across. So I have in my chat, Mr. Pradeep Kumar is also there with us. Pradeep Kumar ji, please ask your question. He wants to ask the question.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, this we talk about media literacy, internet, safety for kids and all. I have two kids, 13 years old and 17 years old. They are on the phone all the time. When we go for some sessions and all, they create a group, then start playing the game as well. I go for a session where these 13 years kids, the ma'am teaches them how to use the internet and everything. Later on, they create his own group and start playing the games in that group. So if we go for some literacy program or, you know, some sessions and all, the kids also come back and they create their own group and they are playing the game. So how, you know, I gone for 3-4 sessions, end of the day, the kids again playing the games. There is no curriculum. And we are also in the office. When I'm free time, my break time, I'm watching the YouTube. It's also like addiction for me as well. So overall, it's the entire family busy, 9 hours working, kids in the school, you do the session, Saturday, Sunday, they go out. End of the day, I do not find any curriculum. So, you know, the kids read it or enjoy it, because reading is very difficult for the kids these days now. So what we do actually, I spend 6 months blocking the net, doing the sites, everything we do it, but still you find something not good for the age appropriate and it's keep coming to the kids. It's very difficult, you know, this world. So I'm really know if some kind of, you know, things there the kid enjoy and they follow it. That's the more important point.
Yes. Please, Dr. Parikh, I think after this, please keep your question flowing on various platforms that we are available. Yes, Dr. Parikh, please answer this question.
Oh, I think one needs to look at it in a slightly different way, and the right way to look at it is that whether online was happening or not, children go to school to study, but they also sometimes learn things that we don't want them to learn by going to school, by looking at seniors, by the peers. And that's always going to be the case. Wherever, whichever platform, virtual, real, the exposure to the non-pro-social vis-a-vis the pro-social is always going to be there. And that's where the education system, including parents and teachers and the social milieu, comes in the picture, where media literacy is important, which means I don't think a parent can control children meeting in classroom and then making their own friend circle. Then the friend circle becomes a virtual group, or they're going to tuition class becoming a virtual group or a real group. That's not in control, shouldn't be also controlled. What one can do is help children understand best utilization of time, understand risks of their behavior, and at the same time realize that children will make mistakes, like adults also make mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes. When they make mistakes, we utilize them also as teaching moments in life and ensure that children have a solid learning of that without feeling negative about their own selves, and then again move forward. And that, I think, is the way forward for looking at in these times, especially with how intrusive and pervasive media is, and frankly, as unregulated as it gets. You're quite right. You may block as many sites as you want, but you can't really stop their access once a kid is on the net. And that's a point well taken. And that's where I think all of us need to work together to make internet a very, very, very safe place for young people.
Thank you. Thank you so much for explaining it so well to our audience. And I think we had a good discussion. Lots of confusion might be cleared. If you have any more questions, please reach out to us. We are always available. We will invite Dr. Parikh again with your more questions and more details to be sorted out, filtering everything that is coming your way, being responsible. Nexus Schools is always committed to building happier and safer internet. Do join us in our next campaign and in our next EduTalk. Thank you so much. Delighted to have you here, and it is sheer honor and privilege to have you. Thank you for sparing your valuable time, sir. And thank you everyone present over here. I hope that we will be in touch through our various social media platforms. Thank you.
Welcome to Next Schools.